Good afternoon, dear colleagues. Today we have our last lecture of the course of classic English poetry. As we don't have enough time to cover all the poets whom I was initially planning to discuss, today I will only briefly speak about each author and will mainly concentrate on the texts they wrote. Last time we spoke about this phenomenon of romanticism, the interest in the individual feelings, in the irrationality of human life, in the history of nations, not going back to antiquity, but rather the medieval period, and the attention to nature, to simple life, if we speak like people, of people like Wordsworth. And then we spoke about the famous romantic poets, Robert Burns and Walter Scott, both of them representatives of the Scottish nation. Robert Burns's texts are more difficult to understand because he uses the dialectal elements in his texts, while Walter Scott wrote in traditional standard English, so we won't have any difficulty when reading his texts. Next comes a very bright poet of the Irish origin, Thomas Moore, not to be confounded with Thomas More, the Chancellor of England during Henry VIII's time and the author of Utopia. These are different people, Thomas More of the 16th century and Thomas More of the 19th century. The difference in spelling is that Thomas More of Henry VIII is written in four letters, M-O-R-E, while Thomas More is M-O-O-R-E. One additional letter. Thomas More was born in Ireland, not in a very rich family, but his parents did his best to give him proper education, the way it could be received in Dublin in those times. And the Ireland of the end of the 18th century, like in other historical periods, was opposed to England. The English became the rulers of the country in the 16th century, but it never caused the enthusiasm of the local population. And at the very end of the century, there was a rebellion, yet another rebellion against the English in Ireland, and some of Thomas More's friends were imprisoned and executed. And since then, Thomas More learned that it's preferable not to participate in such undertakings. He immigrated to London, or rather moved to London, the metropolis. And then he became quite a popular author. He had important benefactors to support him. And during his lifetime, he wrote a lot of poetic texts. The Irish melodies from which we have examples here were the most famous. All in all, there were 124 poems included in the fundamental poetic collection written by Thomas More. The subjects here speaks about are either purely lyrical, the feelings of people towards each other, not in any way connected with the Irish history, or patriotic poems where he speaks about the glorious past and the necessity to resist probably the English at present, which is never done. So вы люди в наше время, не то что нынешний плен. That's the idea of those patriotic texts. And there are philosophical poems speaking about the nature of things. So he was not an Irish patriot displaying only those patriotic feelings in his poetry. He was much more complicated and versatile. He was also a very able musician, and his texts, if we look at them from the acoustic point of view, we will see that they are written with exquisite feeling of meter, of balance, of assonance, of alliteration, a very rare quality indeed. And here Thomas More exceeds even his famous contemporaries and predecessors like Byron, Shelley, and Keats. As he never wrote on subjects of general interest for people, like humorous satirical poems or the present events like Napoleon and his wars, he was less popular and he had no scandalous reputation of the Byron kind. That's why accepted during his lifetime and venerated for his efforts, in the future he would be forgotten, in my opinion, unjustly so. And if we compare his texts and read them carefully, compare them with those of other writers, we will see that in fact he was a first-rate poet, obviously, not only from the technical point of view, but from the point of view of the ideas expressed in his texts. Thomas More lived a relatively long, not always prosperous and carefree life. He died at the age of 73. If we compare him to Byron, we will see that he lived twice as long as his English counterpart. Byron died when he was 36 years old. They were close friends. Thomas More, after Byron's death, even wrote a biography of Byron. He tried to speak delicately about the more problematic aspects of Byron's life. And of course, later biographers lamented the delicacy with which Thomas More treated the events of his friend's life. But even now, in spite of all inner censorship introduced by Thomas More, the book remains quite an interesting reading, and I invite those who are interested in Byron's biography and in Thomas More as an author to get acquainted with the text. A romantic poet throughout, a very capable one. We have several illustrations here. This is the typical poem of the patriotic kind, but still connected with some lyrical ideas. The nation spending time on an island, a big island, tends to travel, so Irish people are traveling, their wives are waiting for them, or their girlfriends. And if you get to France and to England, you see a lot of attractive women, but you should remember that the really faithful, the really deserving women are waiting for you at home in Ireland. Because in France they're frivolous, in England they are hypocritical and prudish, and of course they are absolutely worthless compared to the Irish women. That's the idea of the poem. Not particularly complicated, but the text is written brilliantly, in my opinion. We may roam through this world like a child at a feast, who but sips of a sweet and then flies to the rest. And when pleasure begins to grow dull in the east, we may order our wings and be off to the west. But if hearts that feel and eyes that smile are the dearest gifts that heaven supplies, we never need leave our own green isle for sensitive hearts and for sunbright eyes. Then remember, wherever your goblet is crowned, through this world, whether eastward or westward you roam, when a cup to the smile of dear woman goes round, oh, remember the smile which adorns her at home. In England, the garden of beauty is kept by a dragon of prudery placed within call. But so oft this unnameable dragon has slept that the garden's but scarcely watched after all. Oh, they wander wild, sweet briar offence, which round the flowers of Erin dwells, which wants the touch while winning the sense, nor charms us least when it most repels. Then remember, wherever your goblet is crowned, through this world, whether eastward or westward you roam, when a cup to the smile of dear woman goes round, oh, remember the smile which adorns her at home. In France, when the heart of the woman sets sail on the ocean of wedlock is fortune to try, love seldom goes far in a vessel so frail, but just piles her off and then bids her goodbye. While the daughters of Erin keep the boy, ever smiling beside the faithful oar, through billows of woe and beams of joy, the same as he looked when he left the shore. Then remember, wherever your goblet is crowned, through this world, whether eastward or westward you roam, when a cup to the smile of the woman goes round, oh, remember the smile which adorns her at home. The next text, patriotic yet again, but not too patriotic. A woman had lost her beloved. The beloved one lived for two things, for his country and for his lady friend. Now he is lost. People are trying to console the woman, but she knows that the only consolation for her would be death, because she can't live without the loved one. Very touching text, not very complicated and very carefully written. She is far from the land where her young hero sleeps, and lovers around her sighing. But coldly she turns from their gaze and weeps, for her heart in his grave is lying. She sings the wild song of her dear native plains, every note which he loved awaking. Oh, little they sing who delight in her strains, how the heart of the minstrel is breaking. He had lived for his love, for his country he died. They were all that to life had entwined him. Nor soon shall the tears of his country be dried, nor long will his love stay behind. Oh, make her a grave where the sunbeams rest, when they promise a glorious morrow. They'll shine o'er her sleep like a smile from the west, from her own loved island of sorrow. And the last poem, I give only the beginning of it. There are three stanzas. Again, a person thinking of what is going to happen after his death, and very quietly, calmly speaks about his love to the world he is leaving, the love to his friends. When in death I shall come recline, oh, bear my heart to my mistress dear. Tell her it lived upon smiles and wine of the brightest hue while it lingered here. Bid her not shed one tear of sorrow to sully a heart so brilliant and light, but balmy drops of the red grape borrow to bake the relic from moon till night. Thomas More can be read indefinitely. I am a great fan of his poetry. We will stop at that, but to those who are interested, I recommend The Irish Melodies by Thomas More as really excellent piece of reading. Now from the patriotic Scottish-Irish poets who also wrote lyrical texts, we pass on to the much better known romantics, representatives of romanticism. Here we see all the ideas and traits of romanticism displayed by various people in various texts they wrote. Usually, consideration of romanticism begins with people like William Wordsworth and Samuel Taylor Coleridge. Wordsworth, as we see, lived until the ripe age of 80 years. And in the best tradition of the times, he wrote very long, voluminous texts. And to our mind, probably they would be overlong. But there are some well-known poems considered to be masterpieces, which one might be interested in reading. And here we have an example of the poem We Are Seven, a celebrated piece of text by Wordsworth. He is meeting a simple child, and he begins to speak with that simple child. And the child says that there are seven brothers and sisters in her family, all in all. But then it turns out that some of them are gone, some of them are dead. And he says, you can't be seven, there are fewer of you. But she constantly replies, we are seven, which means her feeling of eternal connection of the members of the family, of the nearest and dearest. So a simple child understands certain things better than an experienced man. There were many parodies written on it because the text is colorful. It contains those repetitions of the phrase, we are seven. So many people wrote quite amusing parodies. But if we try to think about the properties of a particular text, we will see that it's not that bad. After all, there is something in describing the conversation between an experienced man and a simple child with no cultural background to speak of. When the child either teaches this old man something or expresses the worldview entirely different from that of a rational man. That's why it's obviously romantic. A simple child, which lightly draws its breast and feels its life in every limb, what should it know of death? I met a little cottage girl. She was 8 years old, she said. Her hair was thick with many a curl that clustered round her head. And then, after a long description of the girl starts to speak. The first that died was Sister Jane. In bed she moaning lay, till God released her of her pain, and then she went away. So in the churchyard she was laid, and when the grass was dry, together round her grave we played, my brother John and I. And when the ground was white with snow, and I could run and slide, my brother John was forced to go, and he lies by her side. How many are you then, said I, if they too are in heaven? Quick was the little maid's reply, O master, we are seven. But they are dead, those two are dead, their spirits are in heaven. 'Twas throwing words away, for still the little maid would have her will and say, Nay, we are seven. Nature, simple life, opposition to complications of education. We will see it all in Tolstoy's War and Peace, as we understand as our writers owe a lot to their contemporaries and predecessors who were writing in other languages. Which is an interesting reading, if somewhat long-winded. But here I will confine myself just to one text, because either, again, you do it for years or you stop after a brief introduction. Samuel Taylor Coleridge, a mystically minded person, and this mystical mindedness was aggravated by him being constantly in pain due to some neurological complications of some illness. And so he was a dipsomaniac, a drunkard, and a drug eater. So it is difficult very often to say where the rationality stops in his case and where the effects of the drugs or alcohol display themselves. But as a mystical writer, he was very much in the spirit of the age, because mysticism was the normal part of Romanticism as well. And when we read The Queen of Spades, Pikova Dama by Pushkin, and we understand its connection with Anna Radcliffe's texts, or when we read Mary Shelley, Frankenstein, we will see that these ideas were quite typical at that age. So the rhyme of the Ancient Mariner, a ship sailing somewhere, and then the member of the crew killing the albatross, which is a sacred bird, and killing this bird presages very great troubles in the lives of people who participated in it. A brief example, again, some of you may feel later like reading him. At length did cross an albatross, throughout the fog it came, and if it had been a Christian soul, we hailed it in God's name. It ate the food it ne'er had eat, and round it flew, and ice had split with a sunder foot, the helmets steered us through. And a good sound wind sprung up behind, the albatross did follow, and every day for food or play came to the mariner's hollow. In midst of cloud, on mast or shroud, it perched for vesper's name, whilst all the night, through fog smoke white, glimmered the white moonshine. God save thee, ancient mariner, from the fiends that plague thee thus. Why look'st thou so? With my crossbow I shot the albatross. Some of you might feel probably like going on with reading here. And a text by another author, an American one, whom we know because of his mystical prosaic texts, Edgar Allan Poe, the famous text, The Raven. Again, a person is suffering because he had lost his loved one, and probably he's a bit intoxicated, the way it often happened in Edgar Allan Poe's life. And then he hears somebody knocking, and he understands that something mystical is happening. He's remembering his loved one, the girl, Lenore. And then it turns out that it's just the raven making those noises. And for the author, in his inflamed, intoxicated mind, the raven becomes the symbol of the impending death, which had already taken the loved one from the author. It's a very long text. I just introduce the initial stanzas. It's technically masterful. Sometimes you feel that probably there is excessive mastery in the text, but as it is very popular among the Russian readers as well, I would like all of you to have an idea of what his texts sound like. Once upon a midnight dreary, while I pondered weak and weary over many a quaint and curious volumes of forgotten lore, while I nodded, nearly napping, suddenly there came a tapping, as of someone gently rapping at my chamber door. To some visitor I muttered, tapping at my chamber door, only this and nothing more. Ah, distinctly I remember, it was in the bleak December, and each separate dying ember wrought its ghost upon the floor. Eagerly I wished the morrow, vainly I had sought to borrow from my books the seeds of sorrow, sorrow for the lost Lenore, for the rare and radiant maiden whom the angels name Lenore, nameless here forevermore. And the silken, sad, uncertain rustling of each purple curtain thrilled me, filled me with fantastic terrors never felt before. So that now, to still the beating of my heart, I stood repeating, to some visitor entreating entrance at my chamber door, some late visitor entreating entrance at my chamber door, it is this and nothing more. Presently my soul grew stronger. Hesitating then no longer, sir, said I, or madam, truly your forgiveness I implore. But the fact is, I was napping, and so gently you came rapping, and so faintly you came tapping at my chamber door, that I scarce was sure I heard you. Here I opened wide the door, darkness there, and nothing more. And then the raven would appear, and the dialogue would begin. The raven would say, nevermore. And the interlocutor would say a lot of other things, and the mystical mood will increase. So we have the example of words with nature, simple life, understanding certain things of common wisdom, much more significant than what is done by the over-sophisticated classicist-orientated intelligence. The mysticism, the patriotism, and now we will have the example of Byron. The lines connected with Napoleon, yet another subject popular among the romantics, the opposition of one person to society in general, or criticizing this person, a more rare approach, and lyrical poetry as well. So it's Childe Harold, Canto, Part 3. There sung the greatest, not the worst of men, whose spirit antithetically mixed one moment of the mightiest and again on little objects with like firmness fixed. Extreme in all things, hadst thou been betwixt, thy throne had still been thine or never been. For daring made thy rises fall, thou seekst even now to reassume the imperial mien and shake and again the world, the thunder of the sea. Conqueror and captive of the earth art thou. She trembles at thee still, and thy wild name was ne'er more brooded in men's minds than now, that thou art nothing save the jest of fame. Who wooed thee once thy vassal and became the flatterer of thy fierceness till thou wert a god unto thyself, no less the same to the astounding kingdom all inert, who deemed thee for a time whate'er thou didst assert. So, first, Napoleon was a beloved romantic character for so many poets. Then it turned out that apart from romanticism, there was a lot of cynicism and brutality and inadequacy. And then the most unpleasant thing for the romantics was that this god, this idol, once venerated by so many people, finally and infamously lost his exalted position. So the Romantics would have to consider both sides of the matter. The greatness as opposed to the commonness and the ability of the Romantic hero to win, and then the inevitable defeat this Romantic hero has to go through. So yet another aspect of this intellectually and emotionally rich direction, Romanticism. Hero opposed to the world, first probably even having some victory over the world, but then inevitably dying. It's not exactly Mtsiri, but something close to it. And an example Byron is famous not only for his longer texts like Childe Harold or Don Juan. And among his lyrical poems, there are some which are very popular, quoted by Pushkin, for example, as an epigraph to one of the chapters of Eugene Onegin. Here is just the emotion connected with the parting, not anything that you try to consider intellectually. It's just the suffering of a person who thinks that he will never meet the beloved one and that the continuation of the relations is impossible. Farewell, if ever fondest prayer for others' weal availed on high, mine will not all be lost in air, but waft thy name beyond the sky. 'Twere vain to speak, to weep, to sigh. Oh, more than tears of blood can tell when wrung from guilt's expiring eye are in that word, farewell, farewell. These lips are mute, these eyes are dry, but in my breast and in my brain awake the pangs that pass not by, the thought that ne'er shall sleep again. My soul nor deigns nor dares complain, though grief and passion there rebel. I only know we loved in vain. I only feel farewell, farewell. No less energetic in his poetic texts was Percy Bysshe Shelley, a rebellious spirit, a friend of Byron. They, together with some women, spent a lot of time together, for example, in Switzerland. And Shelley is known for his rebellious texts. He was also the husband of the famous Mary Godwin, the author of Frankenstein. So quite a creative company of people spending time together and inspiring each other. Shelley would be this kind of a rebellious romantic. Also thinking of Napoleon, thinking of the events in his native country in England, which he treats as an example of reaction and conservatism, the things that no romantic poet would ever be ready to accept. I hated thee, again speaking about Napoleon, fallen tyrant. I did groan to think that a most unambiguous slave, unambitious slave, a text about Napoleon. I hated thee, fallen tyrant. I did groan to think that a most unambitious slave like you shouldst dance and revel of the grave of liberty. Thou mightst have built thy throne where it had stood even now. Thou didst prefer a frail and bloody pomp which time has swept in fragments towards oblivion. Massacre, for this I prayed, would on thy sleep have crept treason and slavery, rapine, fear, and lust, and stifled thee, thy master. I know too late since thou and France are now in dust, that virtue owns a more eternal foe than force or fraud, old custom, legal crime, and bloody face, the foulest verse of tame. So, negative emotional reaction towards Napoleon, but after his death, the situation became, or rather, after his fall, he's not yet dead, the country got into an unenvious state. So the romantic dissatisfaction with the present and thinking about the older times or the times to come as a more acceptable place of living. England. An old, mad, blind, despised, and dying king. Princes, the dregs of their dull race, who flow through public scorn, mud from a muddy street, spring. Rulers who neither see nor feel nor know, but leash-like to their fainting country cling, till they drop blind and blood without a blow, a people starved and stabbed in the untitled field. An army which liberty side and prey makes as a two-edged sword of to all who wield, golden and sanguine laws which tempt and slay, a religion Christless, godless, a book sealed, a senate, time's worst statute unrepealed, are graves from which a glorious phantom may burst to illumine our tempestuous days. So, Shelley, at his rhetorical best. And of course, there are lyrical poems similar to Farewell, If Ever Fondest Prayer. Shelley was not only aggressively preaching and expressing some kind of system of beliefs, political and otherwise, but also there were situations when he became quite calm and wrote excellent lyrical poetry. One word is too often profaned for me to profane it. One feeling too falsely disdained for thee to disdain it. One hope is too like despair for prudence to smother, and pity from thee more dear than that from another. I can give not what men call love, but wilt thou accept not the worship the heart lifts above, and the heavens reject not. The desire of the moss for the star, of the night for the morrow, the devotion to something afar from the sphere of our sorrow. Quite rich legacy, although the author lived for 30 years only. And I'm quite sure there will be those who would like his lyrical texts. There might be the more politically minded who would like his political texts. Not a poet to be universally admired, because the attitude hugely depends on a reader's tastes and predilections, but still a poet whose name should be known. And if we are to make a choice, sometimes we might feel like recommending his texts to others. John Keats is the third among this bright trio of writers, Byron, Shelley, and Keats. Keats also wrote romantic texts, but here we have rather a classicist text written by him. The text about a nightingale, written in a very complicated fashion, speaking about eternal values or eternal questions a human has to consider: love, life, death. His legacy is not too great because he lived even a shorter life than Shelley and Byron. He died at the age of 26, but in spite of this, he managed to leave quite a number of memorable texts to the reader. Darkling, I listen, and for many a time, I have been half in love with easeful days, called him soft names in many a music try, to take into the air my quiet breath. Now more than ever seems it rich today, to cease upon the midnight with no pain, where thou art pouring forth thy soul abroad in such an ecstasy. Still wouldst thou sing, and I have ears in vain, to thy high requiem become a sod. Thou wast not born for death, immortal bird, nor hungry generations tread thee down. The voice I hear this passing night was heard in ancient days by emperor and clown. Perhaps the selfsame song that found a pass through the sad heart of Rus, when, sick for home, she stood in tears amid the alien corn, the same that oft-times has charmed magic casements opening on the foam of perilous seas in fiery lands forlorn. Forlorn, the very word is like a bell to tell me back from thee to my soul self. Adieu, the fancy cannot cheat so well as she's famed to do, deceiving elf. Adieu, adieu, thy plaintive anthem fades past the near meadows, over the still stream, up the hillside, and now it is buried deep in the next valley glades. Was it a vision or a waking dream? Fled is that music. Do I wake or sleep? Rather classicist, not any particular hidden emotion, very carefully written in a very complicated manner, syntactically and lexically. So considering this, speaking about the nightingale as the immortal bird, difficult for understanding, sometimes not very interesting to read if you are not ready to spend time deciphering these texts. But still, it was necessary for me to give an example of what Keats' poetry is like. Now we turn to a poet who may be called romantic, and he's famous for longer texts, Ulysses, for instance, Ulysses, Odyssey, or longer ballads, on certain historical or invented historical events. It's Alfred Lord Tennyson. He was ennobled by Queen Victoria. He had the honorary title of a poet laureate who wrote for the Queen when it was necessary some solemn texts, and for this he was remunerated, he was paid. So, received remuneration. But if we think about him as a great poet, and this is the title he definitely deserves, it is connected with his long series of texts, which he was writing for about 17 years. This is a collection of texts in memoriam of a certain person called Arthur Henry Helm. He was a friend of Tennyson. They were studying together at Oxford, if I'm not mistaken. Tennyson was a shy person, and it was difficult for him to establish any emotional or intellectual connections, relations with people, while this man, Arthur Henry Helm, on the contrary, was hugely popular among his fellow students. He was a sportsman, an intellectual, and they made a kind of unlikely friendship between each other, and due to Arthur's help, Alfred became popular among his classmates, groupmates, fellow students as well. And Alfred needed this protection and help in his life generally. And as Arthur was planning to marry Tennyson's sister, there was hope that they would enjoy in the future some kind of friendship, with one person patronizing the other and the other giving the necessary emotional contribution to the life of this sportsman boy. But then it so happened that the boy caught some infection and he died at the age of 23, not marrying Tennyson's sister naturally, and it was a huge blow for the poet. And then during the oncoming years, he was writing texts in the memory of his dead friend. Some of them, of course, are like technical exercises, because you can't write 153 poems being constantly on a high level of poetic sophistication. But some others, I believe, belong to the category of brightest texts ever written in English. And these texts by Tennyson, generally, of course, deserve the reader's attention. They are not terribly complicated, although sometimes there are unusual images, otherwise he would not be able to write his 153 poems. Emotion is there, the ideas are clear. I cannot live without you, I constantly think about you. Probably it's better for me not to have had this experience in life, because now it's so painful. Oh no, still I'm grateful for the relations we had, purely platonic naturally. Because if I had not had this experience, my life now would have been senseless and poor. Now it's difficult and almost unbearable, but at least there is some sense in it. Purely romantic, purely subjective, emotional texts, which I think you will enjoy reading. The path by which we twain did go, which led by tracks that pleased us well, through four sweet years arose and fell, from flower to flower, from snow to snow. And we with singing cheered away, and crowned with all the season left, lent, from April on to April went, and glad at heart from May to May. But where the path we walked began to slant the fifth autumnal slope, as we descended following hope, there sat the shadow feared of man, who broke our fair companionship, and spread his mantle dark and cold, and wrapped thee formless in the fold, and dulled the murmur of thy lip, and bore thee where I could not see nor follow, though I walk in haste, and think that somewhere in the waste the shadow sits and waits for me. Now I remember the days when we were together with admiration, with joy. Were they really that delightful when they were actually going on and happening? I don't quite know. Maybe it's the nature of a human being that he remembers the past with delight and reconsiders and beautifies these days. And was the day of my delight as pure and perfect as I say, as the very source and fount of day is dashed with wandering isles of night. If all was good and fair we met, this earth had been the paradise, it never looked to human eyes since our first sun arose and set. And is it that the haze of grief makes former gladness loom so great? the lowness of the present state that sets the past in this relief, or that the past will always win a glory from its being far, and all into the perfect star we saw not when we moved therein. Poem number 27 is the celebrated piece from the collection of poems. It is completed by two lines, which is quite impossible to forget. The idea is, I don't envy indifference, although I suffer because of my emotions. I would have preferred to feel indifferent, but I don't want it. I envy not those who are indifferent. I don't envy the wild. Of course, it's pleasant to be more active than just a soaring person, but I don't want this senseless energy. I don't want indifference, I don't want senseless energy, and I don't want to be as unemotional as some creatures are. Although, again, I'm suffering from emotion, I'm suffering from lack of energy, I'm suffering from lack of indifference, but I don't want to become unemotional, wild, or indifferent. And I believe that whatever happens, it's better to have loved and lost than never to have loved at all. An unusual connection of images leading to this terribly emotional conclusion. I envy not in any moods the captive void of noble rage, the leonard born within the cage that never knew the summer woods. I envy not the beast that takes his license in the field of tame, unfettered by the sense of crime, to whom a conscience never wakes. Nor what may count itself as blessed, the heart that never plighted troths, but stagnates in the weeds of sloughs, nor any want begotten rest. I hold it true, whate'er befall. I feel it when I sorrow most. 'Tis better to have loved and lost than never to have loved at all. Two more examples from Tennyson. You will read them by yourself. So, an excellent lyrical poet, also writing some texts about the invented events of the past of medieval times, and a good reading, after all. Robert Browning, to some extent, resembles William Blake, to some extent, resembles metaphysical poets, deeply pessimistic, terribly aggressive when it comes to people he dislikes. For example, he's addressing William Wordsworth, saying that once he was an idol for the author, for Robert Browning himself. And then there followed the terrible disappointment in this person. Or a text based on Shakespeare's play, The Tempest, where the ugly creature speaks his mind and expresses his dark thoughts in very much the same manner that a Shakespearean character would do it. Caliban upon Setebos. Not the most recognized poet, the best known poet of the 19th century, but obviously a master of his medium. Just for a handful of silver he left us, just for a ribbon to stick in his coat, found the one gift of which fortune bereft us, lost all the others she lets us devote. They, with the gold to give, doled him out silver, so much that theirs, who's so little allowed. How all our copper had gone for his service. Rags, they were purple, his heart had been proud. We that had loved him so, followed him, honored him, lived in his mild and magnificent eye, learned his great language, caught his clear accents, made him our pattern to live and to die. Shakespeare was of us. Milton was for us. Burns, Shelley were with us. They watch from their graves. He alone breaks from the van and the free men. He alone sinks in the rear and the slaves. Very aggressive, as we see, which is quite natural for emotional people when they get disappointed at something or someone. They're ready to say it in so many unpleasant words. So there would be dialogues, there would be commentaries from those writers on each other, on the political life of the contemporary Europe. This is also typical of romantics. They don't merely speak of the past, they spoke about the present and the future as well. And very often they quite emotionally condemned those who, in their opinion, deserved their consternation. I had to mention him, although he's not a favorite poet of mine. And now we're passing on to the last group of poets, those who came after Romanticism, although there is very often a romantic element in their texts. I introduce them because they clearly should be considered, their works should be considered among the masterpieces of English poetry. The biography of these people was not terribly eventful. If we speak about the great, for example, political events which took place in England or in America in those times, but the private lives could have been very tragic, like that of Algernon Charles Swinburne, who lived for 72 years. And out of the 72 years, for certain, he was a raving man. He had to be taken care of on a daily basis, simply because he was quite inadequate, schizophrenic. But he was a great poet, and we will see. Or there is Oscar Wilde, with his scandalous behavior, and this lamentable situation with the imprisonment. He was imprisoned for 2 years, and he served his term in quite difficult circumstances. Before that, he already became a drunkard, a drug eater, drug addict, habitual. And so when he was released, he lived for another 3 years, not in England, but in France, in exile. So quite dramatic circumstances of life, but the texts do not require explanation, the texts they wrote, the way we did it with Shakespeare, for example. I am not introducing biographical material, not because Shakespeare's biography is interesting and their biography is not, but because to understand their texts, which are quite private, quite lyrical, and they do not really require any explanation from the historical and personal point of view. I introduce them just like this, without historical commentary or biographical commentary, because understanding here is possible without any further complicated explanations. So now we forget about literary trends, literary directions. We turn to the text, to the authors, not already speaking about Romanticism, for example. Swinburne was, again, a technically very able author, like Thomas More, for example. It's another matter that sometimes he didn't have much to say. But when he had something to say, for example, here it's a text about the ambiguity of human nature. the presence of the opposite qualities, joy and sorrow, life and death, love and hatred, this is all that you find in a human life. And so he enumerates these qualities in a poetically very memorable way. He's not a Christian poet by any means. Here it's some kind of paganism, язычество. And in this sense, he is very different from Christina Rossetti, who was Christian throughout. And the very first poem we read, "If love is not worth loving, then life is not worth living," very often is interpreted according to the biographical details of her life as a Christian poem, and that here it's the love of God that is being glorified. So with Christina Rossetti, it would be a set of philosophical religious texts in the Christian tradition. With Swinburne, it's something more pagan and not at all Christian, but they both were authors of memorable texts, fixing some emotionally significant moments or intellectually valuable ideas. So with Algernon Charles Swinburne, we have the initial part of a play, Atalanta in Calydon, where, or rather long poem, where he speaks about this complexity of human nature. And he's a very able writer when it comes to rhythms, rhymes, oppositions. Before the beginning of years, they came to the making of man time with a gift of tears, grief with a glass that ran, pleasure with painful leaven, summer with flowers that fell, remembrance fallen from heaven and madness risen from hell. Strength without hands to smite, love that endures for a breath, night, the shadow of light, and life, the shadow of death. Как был создан человек до начала лет, пришли к сотворению мира, время с даром слез, печаль с песочными часами, где бежал песок, радость с болью в качестве закваски. Значит, вот все время противоположные качества. Пришло лето, но при этом с цветами, которые вянут. Разум, павший с небес, и безумие, восставшее из ада. Это все качества, присутствующие, феномены при создании человека. Человек наделен силой, без рук, с помощью которых он мог бы разить. То есть сил есть, убить не может. Любовь, которая тянется лишь мгновение, ночь пришла к созданию человека, тень света и жизнь, тень смерти. And the high gods took in hand fire and the falling of tears, and the measure of sliding sand from under the feet of the years, and frost and drift of the sea, and dust of the laboring earth, and bodies of things to be in the houses of death and of birth. And wrought with weeping and laughter, and fashioned with loathing and love, with life before and after, and death beneath and above, for a day and a night and a morrow, that his strength might endure for a span, with travail and heavy sorrow, the Holy Spirit of man. From the winds of the north and the south, they gathered as unto strife. They breathed upon his mouth. They filled his body with life. Eyesight and speech they wrought for the veils of the soul therein, a time for labor and thought, a time to serve and to sin. They gave him light in his ways, and love, and a space for delight, and beauty, and length of days, and night, and sleep in the night. His speech is a burning fire, with his lips he travels, in his heart is a blind desire, in his eyes full knowledge of death. He weaves and is clothed with derision, sows and he shall not reap. His life is a watch or a vision between a sleep and a sleep. Something resembling Ecclesiastes about the futility of human life, beautifully written, a very good text representing the poetic technique and the intellectual efforts of the author. Christina Rossetti, a contemporary of Swinburne, not a romantic, it's pointless to speak about her belonging to any direction in the development of literature. The author of not so many poems, but quite bright, emotional, philosophical ones. Love has come, probably love of God. My heart is like a singing bird whose nest is in a watered shoot. My heart is like an apple tree whose boughs are bent with thick-set fruit. My heart is like a rainbow shower that paddles in a healthy sea. My heart is gladder than all these because my love has come to me. Raise me a dais of silk and down, hang it with vair and purple dyes, carve it with in doves and pomegranates, and peacocks with 100 eyes. Work it in gold and silver grapes, in leaves and silver fleur-de-lis, because the birthday of my life is come, my love has come to me. A classicist-minded text by Oscar Wilde, Endymion for music. Oscar Wilde is famous mainly for his plays, for his fairy tales, for the picture of Dorian Gray, and those who can tolerate texts of this kind probably will enjoy reading the Ballad of the Reading Jail. It's another matter that there are so many repetitions in the text that sometimes we feel that he had overdone the verbal side of it, though emotion is quite strong. But apart from his plays, very witty, full of paradoxes, apart from the picture of Dorian Gray, in the period before his imprisonment, or rather during his younger years, Oscar Wilde, who had received a classical education, would periodically be writing poetry. And so it's the ancient character, Endymion, and it's an imitation of a classical text, not in any way romantic, quite long, Milton-like repetitions, poetically made in a very subtle way, conceptually not terribly profound, but still an interesting reading for those who would like to have some idea of the rich personality, tragic personality of the creator of the text. Not only fairy tales, not only witty plays and Dorian Gray, not only the Ballad of Reading Jail, but some not numerous poems in the classical tradition. So Oscar Wilde writing a poem in this classicist tradition. The apple trees are hung with gold and birds are loud in Arcady. The sheep lie bleating in the field. The wild goat runs across the world. But yesterday his love he told, I know he will come back to me. It's a woman addressing a man, so no inappropriate relations described. O rising moon, O lady moon, be you my lover's sentinel. You cannot choose but know him well, for he is shod with purple shoe. You cannot choose but know my love, for he a shepherd's crook does bear, and he is soft as any dove, and brown and curly is his hair. The turtle now has ceased to call upon her crimson-footed groom. The gray wolf prowls about the stall. The lily's singing seneschal steeps in the lily bell, and all the violet hills are lost in gloom. O risen moon, O holy moon, stand on the top of Helice, and if my own true love you see, or if you see the purple shoon, the hazel crook, the lad's brown hair, the goatskin wrapped about his arm, tell him that I am waiting where the rushlight glimmers in the farm. The falling dew is cold and chill, and no bird sings in Arcady. The little fawns have left the hill, even the tired daffodil has closed its gilded doors, and still my lover comes not back to me. False moon, a waning moon, where is my own true lover gone? Where are the lips vermilion, the shepherd's crook, the purple shoon? Why spread this silver pavilion? Why wear that veil of drifting mist? Ah, thou hast young Endymion. Thou hast the lips that should be kissed. The boy didn't come. That's the trouble. Walt Whitman, a very peculiar poet, and I'm using this word in its direct meaning, very popular among some readers, a person quite wild in his habits and views, and the author of texts which would later be appreciated in the 20th century, uncontrolled energy, optimism. I wouldn't say that, in my opinion, he expresses any profound ideas, but the wild, but the wild energy, the wild optimism is there. The American writer, among those whom we speak about, we have from the American side, Edgar Allan Poe, we have Walt Whitman, we have Henry Wadsworth Longfellow, and we also have T.S. Eliot, who began as a British writer, then he immigrated and became an American writer. So American poetry is included in the list of classical poetic texts, but the contribution of the British is much greater. And the 20th century was rich both in English and American poets, but for lack of time, we're not speaking about them here. And our list of classical poets, when it comes to the 20th century, is represented by William Butler, Yeats, and T.S. Eliot only. But probably some other day, we might have a course on modern British and American poetry. So Walt Whitman, wild energy, and not terribly profound ideas. Afoot and light-hearted, I take to the open road. Healthy, free, the world before me, the long brown path before me, leading wherever I choose. Henceforth, I ask not good fortune. I myself am good fortune. Henceforth, I whimper no more, postpone no more, need nothing. Strong and content, I travel the open road. The earth, that is sufficient. I do not want the constellations any nearer. I know that they are very well where they are. I know they suffice for those who belong to them. Still here I carry my old delicious burdens. I carry them, men and women. I carry them with me for wherever I go. I swear it's impossible for me to get rid of them, and I am filled with them, and I will fill them in return. Not a text I personally would learn and recite to myself during sleepless nights, but it might be interesting to some readers. That's why I mention the name of the author and give an example. William Butler Yeats, if we speak about directions, modernism, postmodernism, with Elgin Charles Swinburne, as it would be symbolism, like with Christina Rossetti. And William Butler Yeats was a thoughtful man, an Irishman, I think. So certain texts are connected with his native country. And it's a person who had the experience of meeting people and learning something about the way the First World War was going on. And like T.S. Eliot in his Wasteland, expressing rather grim and pessimistic views on the future of humanity. And probably in this he was quite right. I know that I shall meet my fate somewhere among the clouds above. Those that I fight, I do not hate. Those that I guard, I do not love. My county is Kiltartan crows. My countrymen, Kiltartan's poor. No likely end would bring them loss or leave them happier than before. No law, no duty bade me fight. No public men, no cheering crowds. A lonely impulse of delight drove to the tumult in the clouds. I balanced all, brought all to mind. The years to come seemed waste of breath. A waste of breath the years behind. A balance, in balance with this life, this death. Philosophical, expressive, very delicate, not at all wordy, William Butler Yeats wrote such texts, and probably some of you will feel like reading them. And the poem with which I would like to finish our course, it's Henry Wadsworth Longfellow, an American author. The author of long texts, ballads, long poems containing American folklore, indigenous tribes would be mentioned and so on. But here it's a poem written by a very wise person close to the end of his life about life as it is, which is full of suffering, full of hardships. But he invites people not to feel pessimistic, not to think about this, but to act during each day, try to enjoy each day. And in this case, your life will have some meaning and you will feel some pleasure. A lot of translations into Russian exist. If necessary, you might turn to them. Tell me not in mournful numbers, life is but an empty dream. For the soul is dead that slumbers, and things are not what they seem. Life is real, life is earnest, and the grave is not its goal. Dust thou art to dust returnest, wasn't spoken of the soul. Not enjoyment and not sorrow is our destined end or way, but to act that each tomorrow find us farther than today. Art is long and time is fleeting, and our hearts, though stout and brave, still like muffled drums are beating funeral marches to the grave. In the world's broad field of battle, in the bivouac of life, be not like dumb driven cattle, be a hero in the strife. Trust no future, however pleasant, let the dead past bury its dead. Act, act in the living present, heart within and God overhead. Lives of great men all remind us, we can make our lives sublime. And departing, leave behind us footprints on the sands of time. Footprints that perhaps another, sailing over life's solemn main, A forlorn and shipwrecked brother seeing shall take heart again. Let us then be up and doing with a heart for any fate, still achieving, still pursuing, learn to labor and to wait. So now we complete our course of lectures, which began with the old English poetry texts written more than 1,000 years ago. It was a very solid tradition upon which the English could build their future literature, had it not been for the interruption connected with the Norman invasion. Then for another 300 years, very little of literary importance was actually happening in England. But then the political event took place, which changed the course of the development of the English language. The Hundred Years' War with France made it unpatriotic for the English people to speak French. And so the literature in the vernacular began to appear, connected with the names of Chaucer, Gower, and William Langland. But it would be wrong to see the connection of the efflorescence of the English language with the names of great writers only. We have a very significant tradition connected with the heretical writings of the times, the Lollard writings, and the all-important translation of the Bible into English by people following John Wycliffe and Wycliffe himself. The translation was carried out from the Latin version of Saint Jerome of the 4th century and not from the ancient Greek and Hebrew original. But it was hugely popular, although it was destroyed in the decades to come. And this particular source of standardization of the language and of creating a complicated literary language should not be underestimated. And of course, there was the activity of the clerks of the Chancery, who also made a great contribution to creating a standardized, literary, complicated English language applicable to all spheres of human life for the time being, with the exception of science, which was in Latin till the 17th and the 18th centuries. Then again came a period of some cultural decay connected with the unfortunate end of the Hundred Years' War and then the Wars of the Roses, which were going on for 30 years from the year 1455 till the year 1485. But then the Tudor dynasty came to power, relative peace was established in the country, education was raised to a considerable level, and it was the time when a new literature, already connected with the modern English language, began to appear. Again, we should remember here about the all-important tradition of the Bible translation, the names of Coverdale and Tyndall, the creators of the great Bible, upon whose writings the Genevan Bible would be based, upon which the King James Bible would be based. And this text, as we remember, had been considered the significant English literary text, comparable only to Shakespeare in its influence on the future writings of so many English authors. Not even Milton is mentioned in this classification. Shakespeare and the King James Bible stand apart. So there was this tradition, there was the tradition of translating texts of classical, ancient Greek, Latin literature, and also of the French and Italian texts. Also there was the vernacular tradition of writing dramatic texts devoted to the life of Jesus Christ, the life of the prophets, the apostles, and the rhetorical fights between good and bad, evil and goodness. So this was the tradition, among other things, leading to the efflorescence of the English language and of the English literature during the reign of Queen Elizabeth. Two most important genres should be taken into account: dramatic texts, with their further subdivision into tragedy, comedy, and history plays, and lyrical poetry side by side with longer texts based on classical plots or purely invented by the authors, the way it was the case with Edmund Spenser. So quite a number of talented, really talented authors in that period. We usually associate Elizabethan literature with drama, but there was also poetry, and we dealt with some texts illustrating this point. When we speak about Elizabethan England, the all-important conflict between Catholics and Protestants should not be overlooked, because it was the key problem, both intellectually and politically, administratively, for the people living in those times in Europe generally, not only in England. That's why it's impossible to understand so many texts by Shakespeare, for example, if we fail to understand the basic conflicts of the epoch. When we turn to Robert Burns or to Thomas More, we do not require this kind of commentary, or to Swinburne or to Christine Rossetti. And when we speak about Byron, for example, and Shelley, in the political texts, in connection with the political texts they wrote, we need a very modest explanation concerning Napoleon and the French Revolution. But with Shakespeare and his contemporaries, a commentary should be much longer, because otherwise their texts would become or remain incomprehensible. Then comes the 17th century with its unfavorable conditions for the development of literature, the censorship introduced during the reign of James I, the unfortunate and very problematic situation in the country during the reign of Charles I, which ended up in his execution in 1649, the closing of the theaters, and severe censorship imposed by the government yet again. And then comes the year of the Restoration, 1660, when again literature began to proliferate, more or less, but you don't receive great writers overnight if the tradition had been broken for about 50 years. So we already have classicist literature in those times. Shakespeare would be performed by him, but he would be corrected and cleansed and censored and made more appropriate for some kind of polite society with its ideas of what should be displayed on the stage. And then classicism would develop for about a century in England with its cult of the rational, the intellectual, with its interesting, ironic, and satirical texts. But still, these texts were inferior to the previous centuries or the oncoming centuries poetically, and they were less significant in the literature of the 18th century compared to the prosaic genres and the development of the genre of the novel, for instance. We didn't have examples from Dryden or Pope, for lack of time. These are interesting writers, we could have studied them, but now I'm just mentioning the names because the really significant next period in the history of English literature is connected with Romanticism. We spoke about the basic ideas of Romanticism, the interest in the individual, in the individual's emotions, human freedom, the opposition of an individual to the society, which constantly fights such individuals and usually defeats them. The interest in the past, the interest in nature, heroic past, not the ancient past, but the medieval times. These were the things found in different works by different romantic authors to various extents. Some of those romantic poets lived long and healthy lives, like Wordsworth and Thomas More. Some of them would be suffering from various kind of illnesses, and they could have lived long, relatively long, like Coleridge and Swinburne, or they could have died quite young, like Shelley, who was drowned at the age of 30, or Keats, who died of tuberculosis at the age of 26, or Byron, who died of something because his life was such that even a very strong person could not endure the strain he deliberately put upon himself. And also the authors whom we mentioned today, the American authors among them. The 19th century is much richer in names, though I wouldn't say that these people exceeded, for example, Shakespeare or his contemporaries in their talent. And if you take the whole of what Swinburne wrote, it turns out that the best text still is the one I have introduced today, Atalanta in Calydon. All the rest would be the reverberations of the same text. And if you have several volumes and the one valuable text is just 50 lines long, it shows that the person was ready to repeat certain things, but he didn't have much to say, and he is talented. He is an author of several brilliant lines. But the proportion of texts which are not so good and texts which are good is in favor of the inferior texts. So the amount of people writing was greater. It doesn't mean that there was an equal rise in the amount of literary production of great quality, but the 19th century is a very profitable period in the history of classic English poetry, Romanticism, Symbolism, some followers of Classicism like Keats or Oscar Wilde. So a lot of things to consider, a lot of material for your future reading, and I will consider my course successful if now, or in the future, in the not so distant future, in the very distant future, you will feel like turning to the works of these authors to receive some intellectual and emotional pleasure. Thank you very much for your kind attention. Bye.